Hi, everybody. Woo! All right. So we are ready to get started. Welcome to what is now the third annual community keynote. And I'm going to bring out, thank you. I'm going to bring out the woman who first pitched us this idea and said, wouldn't it be awesome, you know, to really feature, to not just talk about what we do, but to actually do what we do. So that's how it started. And it's been the highlight of the conference, I think, the last 2 years. And I think it'll be a highlight again this year. So please join me in welcoming Eden Marriott Kennedy from Fussy.
Oh my gosh, thanks you guys for coming. It's so great to see hundreds and hundreds of people here. We have a good lineup tonight, and you will laugh and you will cry, and I hope there are tissues nearby for you. If not, sleeves. There's a big difference between reading a blog post on a computer and actually having the person who wrote it read it in front of you. And for the people reading to have their audience, which is usually invisible, all of a sudden be in front of them and to feel, not just to read a comment about what the audience thinks, but to feel what they think and what they feel coming at you. So nobody's throwing up backstage, but there's some nerves. So I want to thank Elisa Kammerhart, Lisa Stone, and Joy Desjardins for the incredible work they do on this conference. I want to thank last year's readers who helped in the choosing of this year's readers. Deb Rocks, Daniel Henderson, Liz Gumbiner, Tanis Miller, Grace Davis, Mike Adamick, Stephanie Bergman, JD from I Do Things, Lori White, and Karen Walrond. And we also had this year a special group. We had a panel of experts come in to help us with the final choices. So we had Heather and Jessica from Go Fug Yourself. We had Stacey Morrison, the former editor-in-chief of Red Book magazine. Anna Lee Newitz from IO9. Katie Ornstein from the Op-Ed Project. And comedian Liz Winstead, who is the co-creator of The Daily Show. Back when Craig Kilborn, does anybody remember? That was, yeah, all right. Okay, so let's start with our first reader. We had five categories, and the first category we're going to have readers from is the life category. Deborah Goldstein is our first reader. Her blog is Peaches and Coconuts. She's been blogging since 1999, though Peaches and Coconuts was born in 2006. Her favorite thing about blogging is that it keeps her from watching too much reality television. Her greatest fear is that her partner will die before she does and she'll have to cook for herself. And her motto is, relax, there's an ointment for just about everything. Deborah?
Divorce is so gay. During the past 2 weeks, friends have told me about four recently separated couples in our local community. All four couples are of the lesbian mom variety. It just so happens that I don't know any of them personally. It may surprise you that I don't know all the gays in my neighborhood, but it's actually not the least bit queer that I don't. The gays do not all know each other because, frankly, the only thing we all have in common is that we all shtup people with the same parts. Oh, and we're all denied equal rights because we shtup people with the same parts. But before I go down a political path, my aim was to discuss dyke divorce, family style. When I was around 11 and my mother lamented the state of the Jewish people, she'd wring her hands together and say to no one in particular, first the Orientals take our valedictorian spots away from our children in our schools, and now divorce. I'm sick about it. I'm just sick about it. I didn't get it. Why are you so upset that the Shapiros are getting divorced? Isn't it better to be divorced than to stay in an unhappy marriage, I asked. Jews don't get divorced, she would snap. And I'd quickly find somewhere else to go to avoid any further tutelage. This was the same woman who told me that Jews don't drink. And I know from personal experience that that information is just plain false. My mother always believed that the Jews subscribed to a higher moral code than the rest of humanity. Any indiscretion was a slap in the face of our people and a punch in my mother's stomach. I tried to ignore her as best I could. But four dyke divorces later, and I'm my mother. I'm gutted that our families are breaking apart. I take each divorce to heart, even though I have no connection to these people whatsoever. It's not easy, this gay family business. Being out loud and proud is challenging enough in this country, but having children is an entirely uber level of struggle. You know, most of us don't have sperm on tap. And there's no dollar store for children, I'll tell you that much. Anyone gay or straight who has not been able to or who has not chosen to conceive children on their own can appreciate the expense and emotional roller coaster ride of fertility treatments or the adoption process or the boundless courage and detailed planning that goes into snatching a small child from an unattended shopping cart. There are plenty of opportunities throughout the making of a gay family for either party to pull out, so to speak. I'm not a betting gal, but I put money down that none of these women thought, we're going to pool all of our money and spend a small fortune and obsess about motherhood for months or even years to have a child with this love of my life, and we'll be each other's support system while we're on macrobiotic diets and flipping out on fertility hormones. And together, we're going to face all the legal and administrative hurdles of adoption, and when we finally have our beautiful child, well, maybe we'll break up. I know that no couple thinks about their relationship unraveling before they have kids, gay or straight. I just wanted to believe that if you survived all that mishigas of family making, you were somehow more committed to your partner than the rest of the married population. I also wanted to believe that my planter's wart would just go away on its own. The fact is that gays are no different than anyone else. Why should we be? Wasn't it a woman wise beyond her years, a sage in fact, who once said that the only thing that separates gays from the rest of the world is that we shtup people with the same parts? Who's to say that my partner, Gabriella, and I won't go our separate ways one day? Once our kids are old enough to cook for me, I might not need her hanging around anymore. Gabriella did not care for that bit and asked if I would consider removing it from the blog. And I told her that I would not remove it, but I would be happy to post her disapproval. Open communication is key in a marriage. I would prefer if families were somehow immune to divorce. It would be nice to believe that gays could show the world how it's done. But it's time to get my head out of that rainbow-colored sky and come back to earth. Divorce is not necessarily a bad thing. It could be the beginning of happier days for everyone in an unhappy family. I hope that's the case for anyone in this situation, regardless of whom they shtup.
Our next reader is Faika Khan. Her blog is Native Born. Sorry. She's been blogging since 2007. Her favorite thing about blogging is the sense of community and friendship it gives her. And her greatest fear is being pitied. And frogs. Faika?
There are a lot of you. Wow. Okay. This post is called Welcome to American. The notion exists that, in some way, every person who leaves their nation to settle in the United States is running away from something bad and towards something good. Frankly, nothing could be further from the truth for a lot of the immigrants that I know. The truth is that in this nation, there are many foreign-born individuals who were neither tired nor hungry when they arrived on our shores. That wasn't supposed to be funny. The leaving of one's homeland is a concept that's more than familiar to me. Nearly 60 years ago, both sets of my grandparents left their ancestral homes in India, and they crossed a man-made border, and they became Pakistanis. And 20 years after that, their children left Pakistan and magically became Americans. So I am a woman who is very aware of the artificial aspects of the construct that we call nationality. Still, nearly 2 weeks ago, when we received a letter from INS instructing my husband to report to his oath ceremony, I reacted with a considerable amount of glee. "Daddy is going to be an American," I cried to our daughter. "Isn't that wonderful? Congratulations, Daddy. Isn't it exciting?" And then my husband smiled an odd smile, not the kind of smile that I expected. It wasn't that usual smile, this really bright one that has gotten him free tickets to Disney while standing at the gates with his wallet out 2 times. This was a sad smile. It was the kind of smile that you force onto your face when you know that you're leaving something precious and meaningful behind. It's the kind of smile that you have to put on your face so that other people are unaware of a pain that resides behind it. You see, like so many immigrants in this country, my husband has nothing to run from. If he lived in India, his life would be beautiful and it would be amazing. He would fit in all the time. He wouldn't have to bend his mind around the most simple of cultural nuances that we take for granted. He would never have to mow a lawn, do the dishes, or clean the pool. So in all ways, his life would have been easier in India. And these things did not occur to me until I saw that sad smile on his face. In an instant, that smile reminded me that being the native-born American child of immigrants is not the same thing as being a naturalized American. We, the children, are beneficiaries. We don't feel that acute pain of turning over an old passport for a new one. We don't feel sensations in our hearts that make us feel that we are somehow betraying who we are and the people that we're leaving behind. I do not have words for my husband on this day that will quiet those thoughts. They might be true. I don't know. I do know this, though. I can recognize that he did not decide to become American because India is a bad place or that the people are terrible there. I can recognize that opening one door means closing another, and that it is okay and completely understandable to feel ambivalent and maybe even a little sad about that. I can recognize that he, like my parents, did this for me and for my children. And that as our children get older and he tells them that he became an American for them, they will grow up as I did with a deep feeling of importance and a sense of destiny because of his actions today. I can also recognize the wisdom that we live in a world where international alliances are precarious at best, and the borders and hearts of every nation become a little less welcoming with every year that passes. At the very least, having matching passports would offer this family this perceived comfort of knowing that we're always going to be together. On this bittersweet day, I can recognize that more than the word congratulations from me, he needs to hear the words thank you. So to my husband, on this day, I want to thank you for doing this. Thank you from me, from our kids, from your family. It is my hope that on this day, your very first day as an American, that doors will open before you to all sorts of joys, prosperity, and goodness, and that this hope will help quiet the feelings caused by the ones that are slowly closing behind you.
Our next reader is Karen Green. Her blog is The Kids Are All Right. She's been blogging since 2006. Her favorite thing about blogging is that it's like having her very own column in a magazine where she's the writer, editor, publisher, and critic. And her greatest fear is that she'll have a wardrobe malfunction while reading her post. Karen?
This post is called Miami. Only one bathroom, the woman behind me looked ahead at the half dozen other passengers waiting for the tiny toilet to be available. I smiled and nodded. I should not have had that second coffee, she said, and we both laughed politely. She looked like any of my great aunts, like my grandmother. She was shorter than me, and maybe age had done that, but if it had, she was retaliating by maintaining a gravity-defying hairstyle. The woman continued, and somehow in the 5 minutes that we were in line to use the bathroom on a crowded flight, I learned that she was on her way to Miami for the winter because her husband couldn't take the snow. I also learned that she was a Holocaust survivor, that she was Lithuanian, that she had been 6 years old when she was sent to the camps, that her father and brothers never came out. I was astonished, not because of her footnote version of her horrifying past, but because I was on my way to Miami with my best friend to share my birthday with her grandmother, who was turning 94 on the same day, and who was a Lithuanian Holocaust survivor. And if you know how small Lithuania is and how big the Holocaust was, then you'll know why I was astonished to meet this woman on a plane to Miami 2 days before my birthday. We met in Vilna, the ghetto, of course. Where else was there to meet someone? We were not allowed to leave, so in ways of romance, you took what you could get. Good thing what I got was so nice. We wanted to be married because we heard that they would not separate you if you were married. It was not true, of course, like most things we heard. But we wanted to be married, and we were not allowed. If they found out you had been married, they would take you away and kill you. Don't look so surprised. If they found out you were pregnant, that was even worse, because they would not kill you. They would make you get rid of it. And if it was too late to get rid of it, they made you have the baby, and then they took it. It was better to get rid of it. But we went to the rabbi, and he said, come back at 5 a.m. So we met the next day at the rabbi's, and he married us. That was it. We came alone, and we left alone. I went back to my father's house, and he went back to his. Love, like so many other things, was not allowed for the Jews. I just saw the lady from the plane. Really? Asked Jen, from where she sat on the bench outside the Cheesecake Factory, holding her grandmother Sarah's hand. I told her it had definitely been her. Soon, we were seated, watered, and in unanimous agreement that Sarah and the woman from the plane must meet, were meant to meet. I ducked out of our booth and found her easily. I apologized for interrupting her and her husband's meal, but her eyes lit up at the sight of me. I explained how I'd really love to introduce her to my friend's grandmother, but not to rush. Please enjoy your meal. I asked their names and said goodbye to Marcia and Friedas for the time being. At the camp, the women went to one side and the men to the other. The mamas held their babies, but as long as you could walk, you walked. At first, they let the children stay with their mothers. My sister Ethel was with me, but only because they did not know we were sisters. I had my maiden name on my papers because I wasn't allowed to tell them that we were married, and Ethel had her husband's name. My sister Anna, too, came later, but only because she also had a different name, her own husband's name. They let her stay in our block because they did not know that we were sisters. If they knew, they would have separated us. Our stepmother was also with us, but when we were brought to work the next day, she was not with us. When we got back, we thought, where is Mama? But they had taken her away while we worked. She was not an old lady, but she was too old for them. The mamas with the babies, too, were together, but only for the first night. The next day, the mothers had to go to work. The babies also were not there when they got back. No, I was from Memel. You know where is Memel? Sarah asked. No, I don't know. Marcia shook her head. You know Memel? Sarah pointed an accusing finger at Friedas, Marcia's husband, sitting on the other side of the table. Ah, Memel. Sure, I know Memel. I am from Grobina. Ah, you are Latvian. Sarah turned towards me. He is from 90 kilometers from my home, she stated proudly. Where were you in the camps? Marcia asked the question as casually as I might ask another mother where her child went to preschool. Kaunas, replied Sarah. Ah, Friedas leaned forward. Me too, 1944. And you? 1944 also, and my husband too. Marcia, Friedas, and Sarah sat back and a quiet fell over the group. Strangers, mere moments earlier, I saw that underneath the table, Marcia and Sarah were clutching hands. They gave us pills so we shouldn't have our periods. We shouldn't have our husbands, our sisters, our children, nothing, not even our periods. No food. One slice of bread each day, and if it was moldy, you shouldn't complain. No warm clothes in the winter, but if you were cold, you shouldn't complain. No shoes. When we arrived at the camp, there was a pile of shoes 10 feet high. I thought, what is that? My God, it was children's shoes. A pile 10 feet high of children's shoes. My sister Anna never got her period back, but she shouldn't complain. There was a pile 10 feet high of shoes that never got their children back. After about 15 minutes, our food arrived and Marcia and Friedis got up. Goodbyes were made, but these were not the goodbyes of polite acquaintances. These were the goodbyes of people who knew what it was like to find out, over and over again, that the last time you saw a person, it would be the last time. Marcia hugged me and kissed me and said close in my ear, "Thank you." Then she looked at me at arm's length and smiled. She looked at Sarah. "I'm going to go home and cry now," she said quietly. On the eve of my 35th birthday, I looked at the woman on the eve of her 94th. "Well," I thought as I sat down, "then I guess I can wait until I get home, too." Thank you.
Our next reader is Liz Henry. She's starting off the readers for the Geek Nerd category, which is a category that we set up for people who are just sort of intensely nerdy about something. We didn't do it to define the readers themselves. Liz blogs at Badger Bag, Badger Mama, Composite, BlogHer, Geek Feminism, Feminist Science Fiction, and Hackability. She's been blogging since 2000. Her favorite thing about blogging is that she loves to be able to put her writing out in public instantly and get responses both immediately and long-term. People remember. And her motto is, never mind maneuvers, go straight at them. Liz?
Geek. Today, I was washing the flowered handkerchiefs my sister made me. When the hankies got wet in the sink, I could feel all kinds of slimy mucus on there. I thought, what makes mucus do that? What's going on chemically? Is there a scale of measurement to describe snot's ability to dry up and then re-slime? Must look up viscosity. Later that day, I spent hours reading about soil science. That led me to giant government websites, maps, explanations of whether the soil in my area was firm enough for tanks to cross or soft enough for mass burials in pits. I absorbed the beautiful jargon of the taxonomy of soil. Then I had this weird flash like time travel where I was mentally telling all of this to this girl, Susan, I knew in middle school. I could see her very kind but skeptical smile. This imaginary middle school Susan sighed and said I was such a geek. She said I was like a boy. Another moment popped into my head. At BlogHer 05, when Mina Trott from Six Apart stood up and started babbling about knitting blogs, I kind of freaked out. I was like, oh my God, CNN is here. I thought you were going to represent and be my computer programming coder rock star, and instead, you're talking about knitting. How embarrassing. Never mind the snot and the soil. Anyway, we're finally getting noticed as women doing stuff on the web, not just as blog writers, but as deeply technical women, and now knitting. I tried to suspend my judgment, persuading myself, well, women do knitting, and women talking to each other on the internet is inherently good, so I guess it's good they find each other there and talk about what they like, which is this trivial, stereotypical, embarrassing, girly thing. Might as well be talking about Barbies and painting her nails. I could see Mina knew she was being misunderstood, and that the media was going to mangle her message. As I thought about this over the years, I understood the dynamic of what was happening. I'm so sorry now for my ignorance and my misogyny. I was so wrong. Now I know that knitting a sock is this amazing thing, like building a suspension bridge, a feat of engineering, and it's like code in that it is actually code, but made out of physical stuff. Textile geeks have patterns that are code that convey technical information. They reverse engineer and reinvent marvelous things, knitting coral reefs and digestive systems and enormous protein molecules, along with socks and sweaters. Now I'm kind of a knitting groupie. I signed up on Ravelry just to swoon over the textile rock stars. As I washed my snotty handkerchiefs that day, I thought about boys in middle school. I don't know why I'm obsessed with middle school. Well, my being a geek made me like a boy. Being a geek for boys meant they were called girly or gay. Being weird for them meant that gender norms, for me too, being weird meant that gender norms could be used against us. For geeks who were boys and then men, I think this influenced and still influences a defiant need to define geek as male. Geek macho insists on heteronormativity, defines girls as a thing apart, claims geekiness for manhood. I'm not a knitter still, but I do have some skill with string. I can play cat's cradle and make string figures. Like hand clapping games and jump rope rhymes, string figures are passed from girl to girl over the years. It strikes me we could learn something crucial as geeky feminists from the pattern of how young girls pass on this knowledge and how that is presented as gendered knowledge, as something girls know how to do. Single crochet is just making a loop over and over with your fingers and thumb, tying the same sliding knot over and over. It teaches the skill of maintaining tension on a strand. It's a useful skill to make a weak cord into a stronger, thicker one. It's what you pay attention to. It's a stance towards knowing and doing. It's about communicating knowledge and process. I learned everything I knew about string from other little girls. Though I didn't realize it, that was my introduction into geek sisterhood. So teach your geekiness and pass it on. It's what girls know how to do.
Our next geek nerd is Liz Rizzo. Liz blogs at Everyday Goddess, and she's been blogging since 2005. Her favorite thing about blogging is that it gives voice to the individual. We share how we are alike and how we are different and unique. Her greatest fear is that there's no such thing as magic. And her motto is, Dio que te hupsala, which means aim high. Liz?
I feel like I let my fellow geek bloggers down because I brought my post on paper. Phone karma. I got onto the blue line at Jackson and sat down next to an iPhone. My first reaction, an empathetic sinking feeling for the poor soul who surely realized their mistake the instant the train pulled away. My second reaction, bomb. A brilliant plan to leave a shiny iPhone on a train bound for O'Hare to be scooped up by some greedy soul and walked right onto an airplane. I picked it up. It looked used. A bomb in an iPhone would surely be in a new iPhone, I decided. And so I held a 16-gig iPhone in my hand. Covet. What to do? I was already pushing it on time, I hadn't yet acquired a boarding pass, and now I'm gonna hunt down Metro Lost and Found at O'Hare? I sat there with the iPhone for a minute. Not mine. I looked up and boldly queried my neighbors. Does anyone know if there's a Lost and Found at O'Hare? I sat down next to this. I waved the iPhone high. My fellow passengers looked at it as though I'd just hoisted a gold bar over my head. iPhone, lost iPhone, and I'm basically offering it up to strangers. A friendly fellow confirmed that there was likely a lost and found at O'Hare. But just as I'm telling myself I'm gonna have to take time on the airport end to deal with this, an athletic girl with cool short hair and a bike offers to take the phone and find a number in the directory to call when she gets home to return it. I quickly decide that if you're going to offer up a lost cell phone to the general populace, you're just going to have to trust the soul who stands up to take care of it. I give her the phone and I thank her. Soon we're exchanging stories of lost phones. Bike Chick tells how a friend of hers had lost a phone and she'd been the last number called, so the person who found the phone called her and the phone was reunited with its owner. Now you can pay it forward, I say. I tell how my phone had fallen out of my purse in a restaurant the night before. It had taken me a beat to realize, and so it sat on the floor behind my booth for 2 or 3 minutes, unsnatched, unkicked. I decide I'm paying it forward too, thanking the universe for the safe retrieval of my phone. Phone karma. The other Metro passengers do not join our conversation. No matter what their assessment of the likelihood that the phone will be returned to its owner, they let it lie. It is on a new path. But at a later stop, someone pokes their head into the train and says something. I don't even hear it. All I know is the scruffy guy in the corner suddenly says loudly, "The phone! You have the phone!" What? It was the train operator looking for the phone, but now he's gone and the doors are closed. Hit the button, the scruffy guy says, pointing. I speak into the microphone. We have the phone. No response. Scruffy guy stands and he tries. And this time the operator's voice replies, what car are you in? Scruffy guy says, last car. I think about making my flight. We passengers sit barely patient, but the phone must go home. I am so relieved for the owner, who surely must have thought it was a lost cause, but tried anyway, because how can you not? The train operator arrives, bike chick gives him the phone, he says thank you, and I look at the time on my not an iPhone and decide I will probably make my flight. I didn't hear the operator poke his head in. If I hadn't spoken up and involved my spontaneous community of fellow passengers, I might have missed my flight while I wandered around looking for some metro lost and found. I am sure that someone could easily pocket an iPhone. I don't know what one would have to do to use it, but I'm sure plenty of people do. But for many of us, we have a collective understanding of how losing your tech feels. The cost of it. The shiny. I am personally so thankful that that phone will make its way back to its owner's hands. Chatting with the friendly guy, we talk about how I'm in town for a blogging conference. You'll have to blog this, he says, the story of the phone. I think about Neil Kramer and Amy Turnsharp's BlogHer 2009 session, Blogging as Storytelling, and I smile. Thank you.
Our next reader is Sarah Kimmel. She blogs at Tech for Moms. She's been blogging since 2007. Her favorite thing about blogging is being able to help people understand technology better. Her greatest fear is that the news would want to do a piece on her for her Organized Moms blog and that they'd video the inside of her cabinets. And her motto is, because moms deserve to be tech experts too. Sarah?
After about the millionth Facebook friend of mine joined the coalition of people who think that by joining this group, I'll magically have a dislike button on my Facebook page, I decided this was a post that needs to be written. We've all seen them. Bill Gates is testing email forwards and wants to give you money. A little girl in some city is sick and needs prayers and/or donations. Or my personal favorite, 100 puppies are going to die if you don't forward this to all of your friends. They appear in our inbox or Facebook pages, and for me, they are one of the most annoying things in the world. So how can you avoid being the annoying friend who falls for every single one of them? If it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. This is a standard saying, but I see so many people that don't believe it. They think to themselves, well, what if this time it's actually true? Or, it doesn't hurt to try. I say yes. Yes, it does hurt to try. You are only perpetuating the hoax, and that is what is harmful. If these things just stopped at the first round of suckers, they would forever die and go away. So yes, it does hurt to try in this case. In the too good to be true category is things like Walmart is giving $1,000 gift cards to the first 1,000 fans on Facebook. Really? They aren't. They don't care. Sure, they understand the importance of Facebook and Twitter, but just by creating their account, they're going to get fans and followers. They don't need a gimmick to do so, especially a $1 million gimmick. So basically, use a little common sense when you see things like this and err on the side of caution. Facebook groups that promise you the Brooklyn Bridge for joining their group or page are probably a hoax. I see this one all the time. Joining a group will not give you a dislike button, nor will it allow you to view who's looking at your profile or any of the other crazy promises some groups claim to be able to give you. The best thing to do is only join groups or fan pages of people you actually like or things you like, such as Tech for Moms. Sorry. Do your research. If you get an email that sounds a bit fishy, or should I say fishy with a PH, then check it out before you blindly send it along. Snopes.com is a great resource for all things hoaxy. Check with them and find out the real scoop on that. The last thing I want to discuss with regards to chains is Facebook statuses. A Facebook or Twitter status is to talk about things of interest to you. I've seen a lot of, if you love puppies, put your status as that for an hour. How about you say what you like so much about puppies and be original? If you want to stamp out autism or support the troops, then do just that. Write a letter to the troops or send a care package and then put as your status, I just sent a great care package to the troops in Iraq. You should totally do the same. Or, I just donated $10 for autism research. Here's a website that you can do the same. These are things that will actually make a difference instead of lacking originality and just passing off a lame chain. I promise to step off my soapbox now. Thanks for listening.
All right, we're moving on to the op-ed category. And our first reader is Susan Niebuhr. Susan has blogged at Toddler Planet since 2006, and she's written at Mothers with Cancer and Women in the Planetary Sciences since 2008. Her favorite thing about blogging is she loves the way it can bring us together and make a difference in the world, one word at a time. And her motto is, the joy of life after cancer. Susan.
Six months ago, colors started appearing in my friend's Facebook updates. Locks of black, some pink, a virtual rainbow. I wanted to play along by posting the color of my bra, too. But I couldn't, because I don't have one. I don't own one. 2 years ago, I had a double mastectomy to remove the cancer that was trying to kill me. I had stage 3 inflammatory breast cancer, a fast-moving, deadly cancer that presents without a lump and kills more than 60% of women in the first 5 years. First the cancer, then the chemo tried to kill me, and both of them almost succeeded. I had to have my breasts removed. After that, radiation, more surgery, and, well, I have some history here. So I tried to shrug it off and play along. All I could write was, none. In fact, I don't even own one, with a little smiley face, as if that helped. I watched my friends play along, too, hoping I didn't make anyone uncomfortable. But what I saw was nothing short of amazing. I'd forgotten for an instant this wasn't about my story. This was about our story. And the mothers with cancer were coming out to play, too. Here's what they wrote. Nude. Nothing. White with pockets. Yeah, you get it. And then in the comments, some amazing things began to happen. Their friends came out to support them, cheering them on. Friends engaged me on Facebook and Twitter, too, talking about it and asking, really genuinely, why I felt left out and letting me know that the whole meme was staged by some women in the Midwest urging awareness of breast cancer. Really? Awareness? Aren't we aware by now, people? Don't we know that we need to understand our own bodies and take notice of changes in one breast but not the other, and call the doctor when we see that something's changed? Don't we know that we need to talk to our doctor about thermography or mammograms? Don't we know? I talked to my friends about it on Twitter. Other cancer survivors joined in, telling me that they felt left out too. After all, this was ostensibly an effort to raise awareness of breast cancer, but one in which breast cancer survivors themselves could not participate. And we're reminded, as if we needed a reminder, that we didn't need bras anymore, that most basic undergarment of women everywhere, that symbol of sexuality, for the simple reason that we had already sacrificed our breasts in a Hail Mary attempt to keep from dying of cancer. That's what it is, you know. It's not a choice. It's not just another treatment option. Women have mastectomies, double mastectomies, amputations, because we have no other choice remaining that will give us a shot at life. Life with our children, our partners, our friends, and our families. And so we tearfully bid our breasts goodbye. We submit to surgery, Weeks of the aftermath, drains and gashes where our breasts once were. We submit to doctors and nurses and students gawking with surprise when we disrobe for exams. We submit to months of physical therapy to rip the scar tissue off our rib cage where our breasts once were. We submit to weeks of lymphedema therapy, taking up precious time, time that we fought for, time that we sacrificed for, but time that nonetheless must be used for even more medical treatment to deal with the aftermath. And then we go shopping. Well, clothes that fit just a few months previously don't fit anymore, you see. Every single shirt is stretched out over the chest. And most new ones don't fit right either. Princess seams, they're sewn to flatter the big-busted and the small-busted alike, only serve to remind us, the no-busted, that we are no longer princesses. V-necks are flattering, but only if they're not too deep, cut to show no cleavage, as our cleavage has been taken from us as well. And for a while, the reminders are everywhere. Every TV commercial with the Victoria's Secret angels wrangles, every low-cut shirt sparks the tears, and every nightgown cut to flatter falls flat, and we cry into our pillow. We are aware, you see. We are all too aware, and we work to escape the reminders. Our friends dance around us for a while. They're gentle, and they're careful. They form a wall of support around you. And eventually, life moves on, and the wounds scab over, and the scars begin to form, until one day, when a harmless meme rips them off, and you realize once again that you'll never be the same. Thank you.
Our next reader is Lissa Rankin. Her blog is Owning Pink. She's been blogging since 2009. Her favorite thing about blogging is collaborating with others to help empower us all to live authentic lives and get our mojo back. Her greatest fear is being put in a box, and her motto is, don't settle for being well, be vital. Lissa.
Hi. My post is called What? We Can't Say Vagina. Rumor on the street has it that TV networks have banned a tampon company for making an ad that uses the word vagina. Tell me it isn't true. How exactly are we supposed to talk about tampons without using the word vagina? And what's wrong with that? Vagina, vagina, vagina. Okay, did I just sound like a little defiant kid? Good. Apparently, after this infamous tampon ad was banned from three networks, they reshot the ad and replaced the word vagina with down there. Even with this change, two networks still wouldn't run the ad. Which means that they then made an ad about tampons without ever once referencing the female genitalia. I mean, duh, people. Vaginas are where the tampons go. Once I cooled down after reading this, I started thinking, why are we so freaking afraid to talk about what makes us uniquely female? I mean, seriously, every single human being on this planet came out of one of those things we're not allowed to talk about on network television. First, a disclaimer. Yes, I'm an OBGYN physician, and I wrote a book called What's Up Down There? Questions you'd only ask your gynecologist if she was your best friend. I actually wanted to name it Coochie Confidential. Thank you. My publisher wouldn't let me. I was told I could use the word coochie anywhere I wished within the text of the book, but not on the cover. Oh no, not on the cover. Down there was suggestive enough. So yes, I'm probably more comfortable with vaginas than the average human. I've delivered other women's babies through them. I've done pap smears inside of them. I've operated on them. I even have one of my own. Don't tell. So maybe I have a special perspective in feeling horrified that we're not allowed to use the word vagina on television. But I doubt I'm alone. Do these words make you feel uncomfortable? Maybe your mother called it front bottom or wee wee or grannies, whatever. But that doesn't mean we can't stop the madness and call it like it is. Vagina. Vagina. Say it with me. Vagina. Ooh, that was good. Thank you. Language is a key part of empowerment. How can we be empowered to be whole, beautiful beings who claim our femininity if we can't talk about it? And more immediately, it makes me wonder, what am I going to do when my book comes out in September and I'm out there on the talk show circuit? Can't you see me now? So, Oprah, yes, I wrote this book called What's Up? Bleep, bleep. It's an empowering book committed to helping women learn to love their bleep. The way I see it, you have to love your bleep to love yourself. Okay, so that didn't go so well. In response to this, UbiCotex launched a campaign to get women talking. They've created a series of hysterical ads that poke fun at the whole sterility of feminine hygiene ads. I mean, really, people, periods are messy. Get real. Own it. I say kudos to them. Let's tell it like it is. Let's say vagina. And let's change the way television and the rest of the world talks about what it means to be a woman. I mean, come on. We've all got them. There's nothing dirty or shameful or icky about them. Vaginas make the world go round. Vagina. 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 Thank you.
Jason Mayo blogs at Outnumbered. He's been writing there since 2008. His favorite thing about blogging is he likes being a dad blogger because most of his readers are hot moms. And he always tells his wife that if she ever gets hit by a bus or leaves him, he's totally hooked up. His greatest fear is speaking in front of tons of hot moms and the threat of potential zombie attack. And his motto is, wish not for a lighter load, but a stronger back. Jason?
My penis is so confused right now. Valentine's Day is a greedy whore. I hate you, Valentine's Day. I hate you because you are right. I hate you because you remind me of what a complacent shit I've become. I hate you because you make me feel guilty. I hate your $50 roses and your fat, hollow, gluttonous chocolate face. I hate your funny digital musical cards and your plush little Cupid dolls. All reminders of my inability to give love consistently and unconditionally. You disgust me with your cheap satin negligees and your overpriced pajamagrams. I won't buy them this year. We own a closet full of unused spa days, gold pendants, and orphan teddy bears. My wife deserves better than you. She deserves better than me. Long before you came along, I wrote her love songs and poetry. I sent her letters that chronicled my unrequited love. I remember that courtship from long ago. She fell in love with me, and you had nothing to do with it. You're a cheap substitute. You're a greedy fucking whore. I will bring her flowers on Saturday instead. I will wear black on Sunday to spite you. We don't need you and your phony trinkets. Go away. Do not disturb. This year, I'll bring her a kiss on the neck, a careless whisper of sweet nothings in her ear. Rear. Or maybe even a foot massage. I remember how to do this. I don't need your goddamn help. I hate you, Valentine's Day. Fuck you and the winged unicorn you rode in on. I love my beautiful, precious wife because it's Friday, not because of you. So go ahead and fall asleep on your oversized satin heart-shaped pillow. I hope you never wake up.
Okay, this is our first design blogger, Stephanie Roberts. She blogs at Little Purple Cow Photography and at Shutter Sisters. She's been blogging since 2005. Her favorite things about blogging are the relationships, connecting with creative people, and experiencing their images and words from around the world. It's an endless source of inspiration. Her greatest fear is that fear holds her back from becoming the person she's meant to be. And her motto is, be a blessing. Stephanie Roberts.
Hello. Last year, Jen Lemon and I won the Name Your Dream Assignment Photography Competition, sponsored by Microsoft and Lenovo. And it sent us on a journey to picture hope. This is my project partner, Jen Lemon, and like a fire starter, she inspires me and pushes me to places I never thought I would see, and I'm eternally grateful to her. Picture Hope began with the story of our friend, Odette, from Rwanda. Having survived the genocide, Odette hoped for a better life for herself and her two daughters, Grace and Mutoni. When the opportunity came to reach for her dream, a life in America, she jumped at it. But there was a price to pay. She had to leave her two young daughters in Rwanda until she could earn enough money to send for them. But things didn't work out as planned, and 4 long years passed. But still, she had hope that they would one day be together. So we began Picture Hope with Odette's family in Rwanda. And for the next 3 minutes, I'll let the images speak for themselves. That was Odette's mother. This is Mama Lucy. She has a school, Shepherd's Junior School in Arusha, Tanzania, and we spent time with her at her school. And she started this school in a chicken coop in her backyard. That Jen Lemon, just inspiring everyone in her path. These people are with Best Business and Entrepreneurship Support in Tanzania, and they do seed funding and microloans to the poorest of the poor in Arusha, Tanzania. Amazing people, and we got to meet some of their clients. This is the journey to Nepal. We just got back last Sunday. This is our friend Renu. She's in Kathmandu, and she started a school for street children. And when we arrived there, she shared her school with us and some of her students. We went on a field trip together. And then Renu took us to the largest slum in Kathmandu, where her children, most of her children, live. And we had a wonderful opportunity to spend time with the kids and their parents visiting their homes. This is Nepal. This is in a far district, far west, called Doti. And we had an opportunity to spend time with some women who meet together in a mother circle once a month, and they support each other for maternal health and infant care. So what I found was that hope inspires action, yet requires great patience, a certain amount of faith, and a wide open space to help you prepare for what's to come when it's time for it to arrive. And after 4 long years, Odette was reunited with her daughters, thanks to Jen Lemon and the generosity of so many of you who have followed this story and supported Odette. And this is what happens when you hold on to hope. That's Dave Lemon, Meg. This is when the plane arrived. This is when we were waiting for them to come out of immigration. Thank you.
Our next design blogger or design reader is Jill Smokler. Her blog is Scary Mommy, where she's been writing since 2008. Her favorite thing about blogging is that she has a network of women she adores who are only a click away, and they don't care if she hasn't showered in 2 days. Her greatest fear is that the big gulp of Coke Zero she just inhaled will turn out to be regular Coke. Jill?
I can take credit for the design of my logo, but the name and the inspiration I owe entirely to my middle son, who was 2 years old at the time when I was thinking of starting a blog, and he had seen some Disney movie. I can't remember what it was, but he was terrified of everything. He was afraid of his room and his bed and his car seat and his brother and me. And the minute I heard him refer to me as Scary Mommy, I just thought, that's the perfect blog name. And fortunately, the .com was available, and I was destined to start my blog. Like any good graphic designer, the minute I had a name, I started thinking about logos. I knew I wanted something that represented me, and I started thinking about my dominant features, which is my hair. So my first thought was to go with a Medusa character with these nasty, hissing snakes everywhere. And I created a logo with an image like that, and I worked the words into the snakes, and I liked it, but I didn't feel like it represented every scary mommy out there like I wanted to do. So I started brainstorming other animals that would get across the nasty, harsh side of motherhood and came up with this lion. And I loved the tongue, I loved the red, it was perfect, but it was a little too harsh. So I girlied it up a little bit and then came up with a star to put in the middle to form as a background for the type, and then added a crown, B, because I, of course, am the queen of everything, at least in my head. So those elements gave me the background of the logo. And the next step was to find a font. And I wanted something that was bold and legible and really easy to read, but that wasn't everywhere you looked. I wanted it to be kind of unique just to me. So I started looking at some vintage liquor labels and some luggage tags for inspiration. And I kept seeing the same sort of fonts repeated again and again. And I thought that that looked like the right font to me. And it didn't quite work until I put a black border behind it. But once I did, everything came together pretty well. And that's the logo. Remarkably, I have a bad habit of starting projects and loving them and starting logos and having ideas and then just being super sick of them 5 minutes later and wondering what I was thinking in the first place. And I love blogging. I love this community as much now as I did when I started. And I feel like the logo fits my brand and myself now as well as the day I came up with it. And I always said that if I ever went anywhere with Scary Mommy, I was going to slap a tattoo on my arm. So I'm not there yet, but I might be someday. So, thank you.
Roxana Samiento blogs at Everyday Treats. She's been writing there since 2005. She loves that blogging gives her a little piece of the internet where she can try new things like design, even though she's not a designer. Her greatest fear is heights, and her motto is beauty is in the details. Roxana.
Thank you. If you've ever read a wedding or a style blog, or even if you've watched Oprah, then you've no doubt heard about inspiration boards. They're a place to keep images and words that inspire you. I don't have an inspiration board, but, and this is a little embarrassing to admit, I do have inspiration notebooks. I don't know if you can see it, but don't worry. I'm not going to tell you that keeping a notebook like this is going to change your life, but I am going to tell you how it helped me with my blog redesign. In fact, the inspiration for my blog design obviously came from a notebook. I love blank notebooks, and I'm always on the laptop. So I like to think of my blog as a sketch pad. So that's what I wanted it to look like a blank canvas. So I taught myself enough custom CSS to make the background look like a spiral notebook. Seeing the blank page on the screen is almost as inspiring to me as holding a notebook is in my hands. My next step was to design the header. I'm a style writer, but my blog's name, Everyday Treats, doesn't tell you that. So I went with a font from the Dedeaux family because they're very popular with fashion magazines, and I wanted it to be obvious when you looked at it what I like to write about. I chose this specific font called Italian Dedeaux because I like the way that the T on the header looks like someone took a little bite out of it, and I thought it was a little bit of a play on the treats part of the name. I'm sure no one has ever noticed that, but I like that detail. It makes me smile. Now, out of the whole redesign, my favorite part was the horizontal navigation bar. In the past, I've used category clouds on the sidebar. You know, the ones where you know, you have all these categories, and the one that you use the most gets bigger. I had those, but I found them to be useless because I never, ever clicked on the categories, and I ended up with so many categories that I could never really find anything, which defeated the purpose. So what I did is that I thought about what it is that I like to write about, and I came up with four categories: style, beauty, nesting, and life. I decided to put them front and center on the header to keep me focused and to help readers explore the site. Now, when people come to my blog, they immediately know what the blog is about, or at least what it's supposed to be about. The pineapple on the navigation bar is the link to the homepage. I hate it when you're at a blog and you're exploring and there's no way to get back to the homepage, so I really wanted to put that there, but I didn't want to put home because I thought it would be confusing with the nesting category. So I chose the pineapple because it's a traditional symbol of welcome and hospitality, and I thought it would be fitting. Now, I'm sure that some of you are thinking that I put way too much thought into the blog redesign. Perhaps it's possible. But the way I see it, how many people that find your blog for the first time, for whatever reason, will take the time to read your about page? How many will find that post that you wrote 3 years ago, the one where you poured your heart out and where people will really get what it is your blog is about or what you're about, which is the point of blogging ultimately, no matter what your topic is? How many people are going to read your archives? Very few, and that's if you're lucky. But every single person that finds your blog is going to see the design. Intentionally or not, your blog design will tell readers a lot about you. Your words are the heart of your blog, sure, but good design is what leads them to read, which is why, of course, blog design is so important. Now, just because blog design is important doesn't mean that it has to be complicated. In my opinion, quite the opposite is true. You can just look at my blog. It's very simple, it's very basic, and that makes sense because, like Eden said, I'm not a designer, and I did this redesign on my own. I bought the images from iStock Photo. I used the TypePad knowledge base to learn the custom CSS, and they told one sentence what I needed to do, and I did it. The important thing is what the blog says about the author. You don't have to keep an inspiration notebook like I do, but I encourage you to spend time figuring out what it is that you like, to develop your personal style. It will make it so much easier for you to come up with a design that is unique and reflects you. Thank you very much.
All right. We've come to our last category, which is humor. Marinka blogs at Motherhood in New York City. She's been writing there since 2008, and she also gives weekly life-saving advice at The Mouthy Housewives. Her favorite thing about blogging is definitely the money. The friends she's made through blogging are also nice because they help her count the money. And her greatest fear is being introduced on stage. Marinka!
This is relaxing. Fantastic news, everyone. I went to the doctor yesterday and found out that I gained 20 pounds. That means I'm really growing and developing. I bet I'm in the 95th percentile already. No failure to thrive for me. Before she weighed me, the doctor told me to take off my boots. What about my jewelry and other adornments, I asked. She said it wasn't necessary, even though I was wearing my platinum and jewel-encrusted necklace that spelled out Marinka loves people who comment on her blog in 6-inch high letters. I got on the scale and the doctor said, "Oh, well, you certainly gained some weight." "Thank you," I told her, because I'm not afraid to accept a compliment and see no reason to be coy. "Let's see if you can go the other way," she jotted something down. "Excuse me, but I'm heterosexual," I spoke up. I'm so sick of people hitting on me. Just because there's more of me to love doesn't mean that I go the other way. "Instead of gaining, you should go the other way and lose weight," she clarified. "Well, how do you like that?" I now understand exactly what Kevin Smith went through that weekend when attempting to fly while fat on Southwest. And I suppose we have to thank Barack, Karl Marx, Obama for these insensitive doctors. Back when Bush was Cheney's assistant, you could have a doctor waterboarded for speaking like that to an American patient. But now anything goes. Lose weight, they say, and ask for a copayment. I suppose I could lose a few ounces, I conceded, because obviously I'm dealing with an unbalanced doctor, and I don't want to be euthanized in a rage because I don't accept her diagnosis. According to this, someone your height should weigh 20 pounds less, she tells me, consulting some kind of a chart, probably astrological. Someone my height, I sneer. Yes, she's nodding. Do you want to discuss weight loss options? I could shave my legs, I plea bargain. You should cut down on carbs, she interrupts. Isn't there something less drastic, I panic? I could maybe pluck my eyebrows. And work in some exercise into your day. She's obsessed. I don't think it's healthy. To be honest with you, I'm kind of worried about her.
Metalia blogs at Metalia, where she's been writing since 2006. Her favorite thing about it is that it's the medium to wax on about anything her heart desires to an audience larger than her family, coworkers, and unappreciative toddlers. Her greatest fear is being the center of attention in front of any large group of people. Also clowns. So basically her greatest fear would be to be performing at a clown convention. And her motto is, cheese is always the answer. Ms. Halia.
All right, this is a little post I wrote expressing my feelings about Twilight, New Moon. Yeah, y'all know me, my name is Bella Swan. Sorry, I'm gonna start again. Yeah, y'all know me, my name is Bella Swan. Crushing on a vampire is also Palin Juan. His name is Edward, look like a damn marble sculpture. No Shakespeare and crap. Yeah, my dude is mad cultured. His hair is shiny. Wait, I'm sorry. His hair is gorgeous and a sight to be seen. Though clearly it ain't never been touched by a Pantene. It's shiny, it's flowing, just like Niagara Falls. Like Paul Bunyan's ox, baby's dude was 10 feet tall. But something bad just happened, hit me right in the gut. It was my birthday and I got a paper cut. No, really, that's it. It was nothing more than that. Then Jasper tried to eat me, and so Edward knocked me flat. Now, time out with just one sec. This is real important to mention. Something that I feel warrants a bit of attention. If just a little paper cut made Jasper misbehave, then how them vampires deal when I surf the crimson wave? But back to the story at hand, though, here. Edward abandoned me to keep me all secure. Looking clumsy on the best of days, concussions to my gourd. I'm bruising, I'm tripping, I'm like ex-pres Gerald Ford. So how exactly is it smart to leave me all alone? It's truly quite a wonder I don't got more broken bones. And a lady Vamp Victoria is out to kill me good. So of course it's wise to leave my ass alone in the woods. I soon realize I see Edward when I act super dumb, hanging with Polanskis and racing bikes for fun. I decide I'ma become an adrenaline junkie. There's been no worse idea since that show Love Monkey. I enlist Jacob to help, and with him his hot ab muscles. Them cougar hoes be tripping. Don't fight me hoes, I'll tussle. I want him, I don't. I'm so damn undecided. I hate him, I love him. I totes just wanna ride it. Jacob soon mysteriously abandons my ass too. He gets all enraged and treats my friend Mac just like poo. I'm mired in what's become a real deep personal hell. But with these boys all leaving me, I wonder, do I smell? Surprise, Jacob's a werewolf, lycanthrope if you're smart. He first blows out his cutoffs, they shred and fall apart. And Jacob's doing wolfy things, ain't got no time for me. So I decide I'll run off and cliff dive into the sea. Sound Decisions is my middle name, but thankfully I'm buoyant. Alas, Alice, Edward's sister, she's usually clairvoyant. She sees me drown. She doesn't see that Jacob comes to save me from Victoria the vampire and the churning sea. But now poor Edward thinks I'm gone and that I kicked the bucket. So he decides he'll go and tell the Volturi to suck it. What y'all don't know about the vampire's Volturi? They'll end you like the sun, melt a little snow flurry. And how will Edward go on and stick it to the man? Drain a rabbi in Times Square, hit a nun with the van? No, Edward goes about his game much more starkly. He'll step into the sun till his skin turns all sparkly. Yo, don't ask me, people, I'm just a mere human. I lack the understanding of vampire acumen. So Alice and I set out to stop my darling Ed, prevent the Volturi from up and killing him dead. Dude's prancing around Voltura in red shrouds with Pentacene. Was like something straight out of Eyes Wide Shut's deleted scenes. No orgies here, though, just peeps blocking me from my run. Somehow I reached Ed before he sparkled in the sun. Some crazy vampire crap went down. Hey, look, Dakota Fanning. Anthem Vampire tackled Edward just like Peyton Manning. We left Volturi promising that I'd be turned vampire. The Cullens had sworn up and down, Volturi don't like liars. So here we are, a promise made, soon I shall be undead. I don't want to spoil things in case you haven't read. For what it's worth, though, I must say, now that we've gotten back, I'd still rather totally do those guys in the wolf pack.
Our last reader is Amy Windsor. She's a contributor to the Bitchin' Wives Club, and she's been doing that since 2008. She loves the friendships and the 24-hour party on Twitter. Her greatest fear is spiders, and her motto is, every day's a holiday, every meal's a feast. Amy Windsor.
Everyone, now that we're friends, I'd like to give you some blogging advice. I know I didn't have to, but that's what makes me so nice. Whenever I see bloggers less fabulous than I, and let's face it, who isn't? Less fabulous than I, my type A heart tends to start to bleed. And if someone needs a boost in stats, they shouldn't resort to LOL cats. I know exactly what they need. And even with your sight, though it's the toughest sight I've yet to light, don't worry, I'm determined to succeed. Follow my lead, and yes, indeed, you will be popular. You're gonna be popular. I'll give you the blogging tools and Twitter rules, ways to get more followers. Ooh, I'll give your website flair, the best links to share, get you to the people you need to be popular. You're gonna be popular. You'll get comments from reproducts for free, get on everyone's blog roll. So let's start, 'cause you've got an awfully long way to go. Don't be offended by my web analysis. Think of it as narcology dialysis. Now I've decided to be your tweep and blog BF forever. There's no taking cover, not when it comes to popular. I know about popular, and with an ad for me to showcase your squee instead of boring who you were, are. There's nothing that I can stop you from becoming popular. Lar. La, 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 la. I'm gonna make you popular. When I see vapid commenters linking to uneventful memoirs, I remind the writers to spice it up. Think link bait, blue beef like redneck mommy, or whacked like blog a sexed swami. Did they have SEO planned? Don't make me laugh. They were popular. Please, it's all about popular. It's not about being branded, it's about being candid. So it's very shrewd to be very, very popular, like me. Oh, this post, it's amazing. I love it. I'm gonna go tweet the link right now, and then I'll stumble it. And though you protest, you're a humorist, I know that secretly you're gonna love to spill it on your blog regularly. Oh! La, 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 you'll be popular, just not quite as popular as me. Thank you.
And that's it. I hope you liked our talent show this year.
Can everybody come on out?
And now, just to remind you what's happening, we need you actually to exit the ballroom because there's a dance floor under here, and tonight we're going to have a little rock star karaoke with a live band. But before that, we need you to exit. The reception is starting out there. The art installations are now live and ready to be viewed, and they're all in the ballrooms down at the other side. And don't forget, Mr. Grayson Chance, his first live multi-song set is in the Mercury Ballroom. First 300 who want to see and then perhaps meet and take a picture with Mr. Chance can do that in the Mercury Ballroom. At 7 o'clock, we'll be opening the doors back up, and there'll be more food, more drink, more music, more dancing, more rock stars. Thank you very much.